A bird flies over the island in 7 seconds. A cart crosses it in 7 minutes. The history of Sviarsk, a small protected island town on the Sviaga River, is so mysterious, tragic, and majestic that through its fate, it is possible to study the history of Russia over the last 500 years. Miles away from Kazan, on the river called Sviaga, the mouth of which flows into the Volga, between the two rivers there is a high mountain and a place suitable for the construction of a town, quite spacious, desolate, and covered with dense forest. Whensoever a ship came, be it from the north or from the south along the Volga, or from the west along the Sviaga, the round mountain which became an island at high water immediately attracted the attention of travelers, and even more of experienced soldiers. A better place for a well-fortified fortress could hardly be found. There is a river line on the approaches to its steep slopes, plains all around. The round mountain holds a dominant position. The one who encloses it will control the most important Volga trade route. This was early realized by the young Grand Duke of Moscow, Ivan IV, who subsequently received, together with a royal title, a very telling nickname, the Terrible. And not even age-old notoriety of this sacredly forbidden for any traveler place could stop his evil, zealous energy. The Black Fortress. This was the name of this mountain given by the Cheremis, the people who lived for centuries on these shores. The place was deemed cursed among them. Terrifying legend said, anyone who broke the taboo would be possessed by the evil spirits resting for centuries in the depths of the mountain. After the dissipation of the Golden Horde, three political centers arise. Crimea, very strong, with the support of Turkey, Kazan, as the successor of the Golden Horde, and Moscow, a young and energetic city. And of course, it felt a bit cramped within the bounds of the Russian states. For Moscow, the gateway led to the east. The east, even the southeast, is via Kazan, no other way. Kazan was both a rival and a gateway to the east. And there was a sky sign to Ivan the Terrible after an unsuccessful march on Kazan. And suddenly, he had an apparition in a dream showing the place he had seen, and he was commanded to build there a town. And when he awoke from the dream, he realized that the vision was true, not false. Inspired, Ivan the Terrible put his plan into life, a truly ingenious, daring, and close to madness. This plan was so audacious that when European diplomats told it to their monarchs, they refused to believe it. In winter 1550, in strict secrecy under the supervision of the Tsar's Dyaks, in the headwaters of the Volga River, in the Uglik district, the work started. Timber walls, towers, churches, and houses were prepared for the whole fortress town. When spring came, every log was marked out and all the buildings were dismantled. Ships with the new craftily created town moved towards the Sviaga mouth. They sailed during a month and reached the place on May the 16th. Together with the floating town on barges and rafts, came a large army and thousands of housebuilders with their families. With the help of the Druzhna soldiers, they managed to assemble this marvelous town on the round mountain in less than a month. The fortress of Sviarsk in that time exceeded in dimensions the Kremlins of Novgorod, Pskov, and even Moscow. In the blue field, a wooden town on ships along the Volga River, and fishes in that river. The town on the ships on the Sviarsk Arms, granted by the great Empress Catherine II, is not an artistic image, but a reality. The fortress was not built here, rather, it sailed here. Where was the place of the great work? Where was the Sviarsk fortress created? There are two points of view. One of them supported in the ancient Russian town of Uglich, and the second in the small, quiet town of Myshkin. Yet, the scientists agree on one thing. It was a place somewhere between these towns. In those days, there were the possessions of the ancient princely family of Ushatis. I believe that Sviarsk was timbered neither in Myshkin nor in Uglich, but a little down the Volga. Why? Let's recall the chronicle. It says that Ivan the Terrible summons Diak Ivan Vyrotkov, sends him to the Uglich Uyezd, to Ushayets estate, to chop a town and carry it downriver. Over there, down the Volga from Uglich and Myshkin, the town was chopped. Besides the Volga, there becomes really boatable and convenient for rafting. Over there, the banks of sand dune hilly terrains were covered by good pine forests from which the town was timbered. Today, the Uglich Museum houses some items related to the construction time of the Grand Sviarsk Fortress. Myshkin Museum also has an exposition devoted to Sviarsk, with its own research on the construction site of the fortress. Studies conducted by local historians of Myshkin on where Sviarsk was built were based on two factors. The first one, where in Uglich Uyezd Ushati Princess Estates were located. The second factor, where in this part of the Upper Volga, the ships heavily loaded with the whole town could be securely floated. Both directions of the research showed both that Ushati Princess Estate and the possibility of secure sailing were in that part of the Volga which is nowadays located between the towns of Myshkin and Mologa on the left bank of the river. The construction of such a large fortress within 4 weeks is a unique case in the history of urban development. For that time, it was not only large and reliable, but also ultra-modern. The fortress walls were 2.5 kilometers long, were strengthened with 18 towers, 7 of which were gate towers. The nativity gates overlooking down on the Volga were the principal gates. Height-wise, they were 13 meters, with portcullis. In the tower above the gates, there was a room for the garrison and two prisons. The engineers made several secret passages to the Shuka and the Sviaga rivers for water supply. The citadel at the mouth of the Sviaga River was named Novograd Sviarsky. A few years after the construction of Sviarsk, a cadastre describing in detail all the towers, walls, buildings, and residents was composed. The cadastre sees Sviarsk as a real town, with all the attributes, the Kremlin, a Possad trading quarter around it, enclosed by an additional wall, settlements, and numerous temples. And they put a wooden cathedral church at the Nativity of Blessed Virgin. And all the warlords and boyars and merchants, rich and ordinary people, built themselves bright houses, and arranged their lives nicely. And all the people were filled with joy and gladness and glorified God. From the northeast and southeast, the fortress was surrounded by the extensive Possad, more than 700 good quality houses, trading establishments with a huge market went down to the Volga. custom yard, special courts for coachmen and Tatar merchants. Here, people baked bread, made saltpeter, kvass, and brewed beer. Nowadays, bright fair Sviarsk springs to life, thanks to the skills of original artists who chose the picturesque island for their creative workshops long ago.
Золотой город назывался Sviarsk.
A golden city was called Sviarsk. A lot of people were coming in boats, brought different products. Carpets, of course, wonderful fabrics, different harnessery, pots, whistles, toys, candy pies. All this was in great number, all produced by Mother Russia. And this was, of course, a huge festival. Then, the population of Sviarsk numbered more than 4,000 people. This was two-thirds of Kazan at that time. The town was overcrowded with crafts and trade. Private merchant capital was for centuries actively and happily invested in Sviarsk. When Sviarsk became a district center and was given a coat of arms, a number of uyezds came under its control. Cheboksary, Sivilsk, Kozmodeniansk, Vasilisursk, Saryavakashaysk, Saryavasanshursk, and Yaransk. At the end of the 18th century, Emperor Paul I prayed fervently in Sviarsk before the icon of the Mother of God of the Domitian Monastery, wishing peace and prosperity to this small God-preserved city. Emperor Nicholas I states in 1829 the general layout of Sviarsk, making the streets of the town straight. However, under the influence of ancient planning, some streets still retain their picturesque curves. Streets of Sviarsk carried through the centuries their beautiful names, mostly after ancient temples standing on them. When the great Russian poet Alexander Pushkin saw Sviarsk, he was delighted. This was exactly the fabulous town on the island of Buyan which he imagined. Nothing but an oak grew there. Now it has a new built city, stately mansions, pretty gardens, tall churches with domes of gold, fair and wondrous to behold. In the course of time, having become peaceful and wealthy, the island town evolved from a military fortress to the center of spiritual life. It gets a unique coloring of this beautiful monastery. The royalty continued to visit the island town. The Kazan Telegraph newspaper of the 25th of April 1913 said, "Today, our commonly sleepy and quiet town was joyfully excited by the arrival of the Grand Duchess Elizabeth Fyodorovna. One and all, young and old, poured into the street." According to a legend, long before the creation of a town on the Round Mountain, the Chemerys heard the chimes from that mountain. All efforts to capture the Elder One to hallow the place of the future fortress were vain. Archers tried to shoot him, but the arrows fell to the ground, broken, and the Elder himself mysteriously disappeared. Later, mountain people identified the Elder when they saw the icon of Venerable Sergius. Thus, the wonder worker of Radonezh became the patron saint of Sviarsk. Immediately after the construction, Ivan the Terrible sent St. Herman to arrange the monastic life in Novograd Sviarsky. Centuries later, the incorruptible relics of Herman are kept on the land that he never abandoned in his concerns and prayers during his lifetime. Who knows how often his way passed by the wooden Trinity Church? It is a miracle that it survived since the mid-16th century. It is the only one of those buildings that were timbered near Uglich, floated down the Volga, and assembled in 1551. Just imagine, these logs were transported on ships almost 500 years ago. The church was consecrated on Whit Sunday, May the 17th, 1551. And the Trinity St. Sergius Monastery was constructed at this place. How did the wooden church manage to survive? With God's help and the builder's mastery. In those days, they didn't use the saw, which tussled the timber, but the axe instead, which gave a plain split that preserved itself. Many icons of the ancient Trinity Church survived as well. The masterpieces of the 16th century icon painting are kept at the State Museum of Fine Arts of the Republic of Tatarstan. Thanks to the craftsmanship of restorers, the antique icons continue to live through the ages. The icon of Holy Virgin, the Joy of All Who Sorrow, painted by an unknown painter in the 18th century, was also worshipped in St. John the Baptist Convent of Sviarsk. At the beginning of the 20th century, the largest cathedral in Sviarsk was built and named the Joy of All Who Sorrow. It has excellent acoustics and the magnificent beauty of space. Its construction was the crown of the reviviscence of the St. John the Baptist Convent of Sviarsk. Reviviscence before its ruin. Very soon, millions of the mourning faithful across Russia would invoke the Virgin. It was the vastness of the cathedral that suggested to the Bolsheviks the sacrilegious idea to turn it into a granary. Sviarsk citizens remembered the tractors driving right into the sacred temple. In 1917, the Russian people were oppressed to the condition of poverty. In the early events of the Red Terror, Trotsky said, "We will prepare a bloodbath for Russia." And he began with Sviarsk. He didn't even have mercy, even upon his own associates. It was in Sviarsk where Trotsky organized his first decimation. He shot every tenth of the retreated unit to improve discipline. Priests and monks of the ruined marvelous island were mortarized. It is no coincidence that in the years of the Civil War, there appeared a persistent legend that it was in Sviarsk where Trotsky put a monument to the traitor of all time, Judas Iscariot, calling him a revolutionary rebel and the first fighter against religious obscurantism. This occurred, allegedly, here, on the main square of Sviarsk, the Nativity Square, which, before the arrival of the new government, was ornamented by the famous Nativity Cathedral. Back in the 16th century, Ivan the Terrible himself was praying here. 6 of the 12 temples of Sviarsk were completely destroyed, and 4 of them exploded. The relics of St. Herman were savagely disclosed and furtively carried off from the island. The Assumption Monastery, the famous creation of well-known Piast masters of the 16th century, was turned to a political prison gulag, where more than 5,000 repressed prisoners died, and then it was turned into a mental hospital. Today, those tragic days are reminded to the descendants by the monument at the walls of the Dormition Monastery. It was dedicated to the victims of political repressions. The dove relinquished up from hands is a symbol of peace, hope, and love. Having passed through the revolutionary storms and trials of the Gulag, once fabulously beautiful gingerbread town, Sviarsk represented a pitiful sight. The town began to slowly sink into oblivion. In 1932, the president of the All-Russian Central Executive Committee of the Soviets declares to exclude Sviatsk from the list of cities of the Tatar ASSR and consider it a rural settlement. In the 1950s, due to the construction of the Kupchev Reservoir, town residents were ordered to dismantle their houses and move to flood-free areas. Having narrowly escaped the total flooding, the town of stately mansions, pretty gardens, churches tall with domes of gold, finally turned into an island. Sviatsk became one of the most unusual and original places in Russia, not of this world. The island was rapidly becoming desolated, almost no one left to live there. For 70 years, not a single new building was erected here, not a single. Sviatsk was dying. It seemed to be frozen in timelessness. No industry, no cars, no modern buildings. The flow of time had stopped for it. Creative people were attracted to the island by its uniqueness, like by a magnet. Here, far from civilization, they experienced an especial inspiration. The first time I got to Sviatsk was when I studied at the art school, and our teacher brought us here. This was the first trip, and I remember it because we were trying to paint some sketches, but we didn't succeed. Sviatsk suppressed us so much with its power and new experiences that no more energy was left in us for creativity. When I got here, I was literally afire with enthusiasm for these old rickety sheds, patched roofs. I have a lot of pictures on this subject. I walked around the island and greedily absorbed these experiences. There is a silence, you know, such a feeling. You can work here, sit here, quiet, thinking even if someone came, no one bothers. They respect your work. This is good, and you respect them all. There were lots of cows and sheep also. It is good for people. They let the cattle walk free. It can't get out of the island. This is an advantage. It needs no shepherd. It walks by itself. The whole herds were here. We're all accustomed to this place, living here for 22 years. My wife bought this house, and I left Moscow and began painting. Sviatsk, of course, stirred a special feeling in me. The plots came by themselves, because this place is sacred. There was a feeling that here we are under God, in a special place. Once paid a short visit, the artists stayed here for decades. They weren't even scared by the lack of the basic living conditions. The natives got accustomed to it and accepted it long ago. In winter, when the river was covered with ice, it was easy to get out of Sviatsk. But during the autumn freeze-ups and spring floods, the life in Sviatsk faded completely. It was almost impossible to reach the other bank, and women in labor were taken to the mainland in advance. It was also an undesirable time to die. The cemetery was located across the river. What happened to those who were out of the schedule? The islanders all in one voice insist that there were simply no such people. But not everyone accepted the irreversible decay of the fairy tale town. In 1960, the chairman of the Union of Artists of the USSR, Academician Grabar, raised the issue of preservation of monuments of architecture and unique frescoes of the Dormition Cathedral. No analogues of them can be traced in any other painting school of Rus. Only here you can see St. Christopher, a soldier who died for Christ, depicted with a horse's head. And at the cathedral altar, you can see a unique lifetime portrait of a young Ivan the Terrible, who was just over 20 years at the time of the grand construction completion of Novograd Sviatsky. The frescoes of the Dormition Cathedral were painted in the 16th century. The ancient icons of Whitestone Church also miraculously survived to the present day. The cathedral was erected in 1556 by Posnik Yakovlev and Ivan Shirai. According to a legend, these famous masters also built the walls of the Kazan Kremlin and the St. Basil's Cathedral in Moscow. The Dormition Cathedral of Sviatsk is a unique Russian monument. The other 20 buildings on the small island of Sviaga were declared monuments of federal significance in 1962 as well. After another decade, the first restoration works began in the survived temples. After many years, hymns rang again on Sviatsk. The old parish church of the Holy Tsars Constantine and Helen was opened. The first president of the Republic of Tatarstan, Mintimer Shaimiev, makes an important decision and signs an agreement with the Ministry of Culture of Russia on the necessity of reviving the island town Sviatsk and the ancient city of Bulgar. A modern grand plan is being developed, but now it's not about the building of the town on the island, but about its resurrection. The implementation of this plan is entrusted to the fund with a symbolic name, Renaissance. A massive fundraising campaign with participation of thousands of charity providers began. Sviatsk is changing vigorously within the sight of astonished islanders. From wooden huts and ramshackle cabins, they are moved to new comfortable houses. New roads and communications are being built too. After careful examination of the archives, the ancient buildings of the island are being restored. The ancient Sviatsk is a real treasure for archaeologists. The island is small, and each meter is of great interest for them. There are lots of discoveries, from tools of labor to traces of wooden houses of the islanders who inhabited this place centuries ago. Sviatsk is very interesting because the river itself is unique. It was not navigable, so it wasn't spoiled by those primitive man sites. They all have survived, and we describe them. It is very interesting for the historian and archaeologist. There are all the layers of human history. Unique wooden buildings, whole streets, tiles and ceramics, household items were well preserved in the wet cultural layer of Sviatsk, formed over centuries. Sviatsk Hill is an ancient remnant at the right bank of the Volga. There are virtually no such places like Sviatsk. The unusual location, beauty of the natural landscape, in harmony with the masterpieces of ancient urban planning, allowed to include the island town to the UNESCO preliminary list of the World Cultural and Natural Heritage. Today, the past and present are here alongside. Archaeologists find fragments of ancient pots, while modern potters make new vessels in Sviatsk. The ancient town is filled with life again, and the saplings of the future apple orchard are the symbol of its rebirth. They were brought from Leo Tolstoy's estate, Yasnaya Polyana, because here, in Sviatsk, Tolstoy's great-grandfather served as a warlord. As a symbol of the connection of times, the sprouts of a new life will strengthen and ornament the revived town with apple blossom. People here got used to the frequent visits of distinguished guests, Indeed, Sviarsk used to be front steps of Kazan since the old times. Persons of title and statesmanlike didn't pass the Wonder Island by. Like centuries ago during the holidays, it is very cheerful and crowded in Sviarsk. Today is a period of change for Sviarsk. It's complicated and troublesome, but joyful and long-awaited. The conservation center of the ancient town is the Sviarsk Museum. From here you can see how the famous wooden fortress looked like. Unique archaeological findings count off the history of Sviarsk century after century. An open-air museum, the ancient town on a hill in the middle of the river, hospitably invites guests for the holidays to taste a local fish soup, uka, to watch a real spear-running contest, to try archery. Guest showmen also please the eyes of the natives, despite the fact that today the population of the island is only 246 people. They are fewer than tourists coming every day to visit the island town. My homeland is here. I don't want to leave this place for anywhere. I had the opportunity when I was young. Many people strive to leave for the city, but I wished to stay here. And when sometimes I go anywhere out of the island, it takes only to return back to this shore, breathe this air, and in a moment, it feels better. I want to say that the homeland of my ancestors will live. It hasn't been lost. For almost a century, Sviarsk stayed silent. Today, the highest building on the island, the bell tower of Nicholas Church, chimes Blagovest to the revived town.